Most Beautiful Chapter 1
I don't quite know why I found that particular town so heartless. Perhaps because of its crowded, claustrophobic atmosphere, its congested and insanitary lines, its wily people. One day I found the children of the bazaar tormenting a deformed, retarded boy. About a dozen boys between the age of 8 and 14 were jeering at the retarded. The boy was 12 or 13, judging by his face, but he had the height of an 8 or 9 years old. His legs were thick, short, and bowed. He had a small chest, but his arms were long, making him rather ape-like in his attitude. His forehead and cheeks were pitted with the scars of smallpox. He was ugly by normal standard, and the gibberish he spoke did nothing to discourage his tormentor. They threw mud and stone at him while keeping well out of his reach. Few can be more cruel than a gang of schoolboys in high spirit. I was an uneasy observer of the scene. I feel that I ought to do something to put a stop to it, but lacked the courage to interfere. It was only when a stone struck the boy on the face, cutting open his cheek, that I lost my normal discretion and ran in amongst the boys, shouting at them and clouting those I could reach. They scattered like defeated soldiers. I looked the frightened, angry boy by the hand and asked him where he lived. He mumbled something incoherent and pointed down a narrow line. I led him away from the bazaar. I said very little to the boy because it was obvious that he had some defect of speech. When he stopped outside a door set in a high wall, I presumed that he had come to his house. The door was opened by a young woman. The boy immediately threw his arm around her and burst into tears. I had not been prepared for the boy's mother. Not only did she look perfectly normal physically, but she was strikingly handsome. She thanked me for bringing her son home and asked me into the house. She offered me tea, but I asked for a glass of water. She asked the boy to fetch it, and he did so, thrusting the glass into my hands without looking me in the face.
Suresh is my only son. I love him very much. Do you think he is very ugly?
Ugly is just a word, I said. Like beauty, they mean different things to different people. The poet Keats has said, beauty is truth, truth beauty. But if beauty and truth are same things, then why have different words? They are relative terms. There are no absolute, except birth and death. The boy squatted down at her feet, cuddling his head in her lap. With the end of her sari, she began wiping his face. Have you tried teaching him to talk properly? I asked.
He has been like this since childhood. The doctors can do nothing.
While we were talking, the father came in, and the boy slunk away to the kitchen. The man thanked me curtly for bringing the boy home and seemed at once to dismiss the whole matter from his mind. I got the impression that he had long since resigned himself to having a deformed son, and his early disappointment had changed to indifference. When I got up to leave, his wife accompanied me to the front door.
Please do not mind if my husband is a little rude. His business is not going too well. If you like to come again, please do. Suresh does not meet many people who treat him like a normal person.
Chapter 2. After about a week, I went to the house again. Suresh's father was away on a business trip, and I stayed for lunch. Boy's mother made some delicious paratha, stuffed with ground radish, and served it with pickle and curd. If Suresh ate like an animal, gobbling his food, I was not far behind him. He was morose and uncommunicative when he ate. But when I suggested that he come with me for a walk, he looked up eagerly. At the same time, a look of fear passed across his mother's face.
Will it be all right? You have seen how other children treat him. That day, he slipped out of the house without telling anyone.
Suresh made encouraging noises and trumpeted the table with his fist to show that he wanted to go. Finally, his mother consented, and the boy and I set off down the road. He could not walk very fast because of his awkward legs, but this gave me a chance to point out to him anything that I thought might arouse his nearest. Parrot squabbling in a banyan tree, buffaloes wowling in a muddy pond. We reached the dry river bed on the outskirts of the town. Seeing trees in the distance, Suresh began to run toward them, shouting and clapping his hands. We found a small stream running through the forest. I took off my clothes and leaped into the cool water, inviting Suresh to join me. He hesitated about taking off his clothes, but after watching me for a while, his eagerness to join me overcame his self-consciousness. He waded clumsily toward me. The water, which came only to my knees, reached up to his chest. "Come, I will teach you to swim," I said, and lifting him up from the waist, I held him afloat. He splattered and thrashed around, but stopped struggling when he found that he could stay afloat. After that, I went to the boy's house about twice a week, and we nearly always visited the stream. Before long, Suresh was able to swim a short distance, knowing how to swim. This was something the bazaar boys never learned. Give him a certain confidence. The more I saw Suresh, the less conscious was I of his deformities. For me, he was fast becoming the norm, while the children of the bazaar seemed abnormal. That he was still conscious of his ugliness was made clear to me 2 months after our first meeting. We were coming home through the mustard field when I noticed that we were being followed by a small goat. Though I tried driving the kid away, it continued tripping along at our heels. So Suresh picked it up and look it home. The kid became his main obsession during the next few days. He fed it with his own hands, allowed it to sleep at the foot of his bed. It was a pretty little kid. Everyone admired the pet, and the boy's mother and I remarked on how pretty it was. Chapter 3. His resentment against the animal began to show when others started admiring it. He suspected that they found it better looking than its owner. 2 days later, when I called at the house, I found his mother looking very upset.
She told me how Suresh, in a sudden and uncontrollable rage, had thrown a brick at the kid, breaking its skull. "I will talk to him," I said, and went out looking for him. I found him near the stream, lying flat on his belly in the soft mud, chasing tadpoles with a stick.
"Why did you kill the goat?" I asked. He shrugged his shoulder. "How very cruel," I said. He took a penknife from his shirt pocket and held it out to me by the blade. He pointed to his bare stomach and motioned me to thrust the blade into his belly. "You are a funny fellow," I said, taking the knife and throwing it into the stream. "Come, let's have a swim." We swam all afternoon and Suresh went home smiling. After some weeks, I received a letter offering me a job in Delhi. The boy's mother was disappointed when I told her that I was going away, but the boy displayed no feeling at all. I told myself that he probably did not realize that he might never see me again. I felt a little hurt. On the evening my train was to leave, I went to the house to say goodbye. Suresh refused to sit near me or take my hand. At 8 o'clock, I entered a third class compartment and succeeded in securing a seat near the window. The guard had blown the whistle when I saw Suresh standing near the turnstile, looking up and down the platform. "Suresh," I shouted, and he heard me and came hobbling along the platform. "I will be back next year," I called. The train began moving out of the station, and as I waved to Suresh, he broke into a stumbling run, waving his arm in frantic, restraining gestures. I saw him stumbling against someone's bidding.